Hi, this is Gary with MacMost Now. On today's episode, let's look at 9 Mac myths. So a lot of questions I get asked actually come from misconceptions that people have about Macs or computers in general. Or a lot of times when people are asking questions, I notice that they're doing things that they don't need to do. Like for instance, the first one is that people quit apps far too often, I find. When you're using a Mac, you can run apps, especially apps you're using all the time, like Safari, or if you're, say, you're a writer using Pages or Word, whatever apps you're using, and you can leave them running. You don't have to quit one app to start another. Some people do this, or they try to kind of manage their apps, quitting one if they don't think they're going to use it at any time. I actually leave just about all my apps running, unless it's something I rarely ever use. Use it just once, and then I quit when I'm done using it. But I usually have an image editing tool, a word processor, Safari of course, an FTP tool, all sorts of things just always running. Even if I don't have a document, open them with them at the time. They don't actually use up very much memory or resources if you're not using them at that moment. So it's okay to leave them running. Matter of fact, it's common that I've got 10 or more apps running on either my Mac Pro or my MacBook Air at any given time. I just don't simply bother to quit them. You don't really need to. And similar to that, I find that a lot of people shut their computers down at the end of the day, something I haven't done for years. And maybe it was true, say, in the early 90s that it was a good idea when you were done using a computer to quit everything and shut it down. But with today's modern computers, they use very little power when they go to sleep. You should let them go to sleep. You don't necessarily have to shut them down at the end of every day. Similar to that, I find people have a little bit of confusion about using the new wireless peripherals like keyboards and mice. They're not sure whether or not they should shut them down when they're finished using their Mac for the end of the day or whether just leave them on. I just leave them on. I've never shut down my keyboard or my trackpad, even though both just use batteries. They both kind of go into a sleep mode. They're not using very much power if you're not typing on them or using the trackpad. So it's not really going to affect battery life too much. And of course, it's a lot easier if you don't have to wait for them to reconnect over Bluetooth when you start work again the next day. Another thing I hear a lot is that people that have MacBooks shut them down before moving them. In other words, they have them on the desk at home, and when they want to go to work or school, they shut them down so they're not actually transporting a MacBook that is on, even if it's sleeping. Now this comes from the early days of laptops. Early days of laptops used standard hard drives. Standard hard drives didn't work well if they were being moved at the time because there's things in motion there. There's the spinning disk and there's a reading head that moves across the surface. And the really early drives weren't made to be used while they were in motion. So sometimes you would have problems with that. But you know, as soon as laptops became popular, drives were developed that not only would work well while being moved, but also would be smart about it. Like for instance, in today's MacBooks, if you were to actually drop your MacBook while you were doing something, the hard drive detects that it's falling and will stop doing anything for the duration of the fall, so it won't damage itself. But in general, you just don't have to shut down your MacBook while moving it at all. I just simply put mine to sleep and carry it with me. But I've even walked around with it on and you know, doing things as I'm moving. It's perfectly fine and won't harm it. And as a matter of fact, the latest MacBooks don't even use hard drives like that. They use solid state drives. So it's completely a non-issue. And that brings me to the next myth. Is I hear a lot of people saying that they heard that you're not supposed to use a MacBook while it's plugged in. I'm not really sure where this comes from. I think some of the early battery type devices, maybe even before computers, had this issue where you would want to charge them fully up and you wouldn't want to overcharge them. But this certainly isn't true of laptop computers. I don't think it ever has been. So you have no danger of overcharging your MacBook. And certainly if you have power available and you have your power adapter, have your MacBook plugged in. There's no reason to drain the battery if you don't need to. So certainly keep your MacBook plugged in when you can. Use the battery when you have to or when it's more convenient. And don't worry about overcharging because that's not something that happens. So let's get away from power and on and off and talk about iTunes. Now, originally when iTunes started selling music, it was copy protected. There was digital rights management on it, and you had to basically authenticate yourself on your copy of iTunes to make sure you could play the music that you purchased. And when you synced your iPod, there was stuff that went back and forth to authenticate that it was your iPod and it was your music and it was all okay. But Apple did away with this years and years ago. And the music now doesn't have this kind of copy protection. When you buy it from iTunes, you can put it on any other MP3 device you want. iTunes even lets you convert it from the AAC format to MP3 if you have an old player that only plays MP3 music. You can use it wherever you want on any of your devices. It does actually put your ID in the song, so it's not like you can just do whatever you want with the song and give it away to people, but you do have freedom to basically use it outside of iTunes on your Mac and your iPod, iPhone, iPad. Now, if I had to pick a number one myth, a myth that appears the most in comments and questions I get, it's about Microsoft Office. For some reason, people don't realize that there's Office for Windows and there's also Office for Mac. And now it's Office 365 and you can get it for either Mac or Windows. And that pretty much has always been Office for Mac. So if you need to have open some old Microsoft Office documents or you're communicating with people that use Microsoft Office on Windows, just get Office for your Mac. It's available. It's same price, and it can open the same files. And maybe the second most popular myth I hear all the time, it concerns Apple's Wi-Fi devices, the AirPort Express, the AirPort Extreme, and Time Capsule. People who don't have one think that maybe they only work with Macs and iPhones and iPads. And that's not true at all. Wi-Fi devices are cross-platform. You get an AirPort Extreme base station and you can certainly use that with your PC that has Wi-Fi. Matter of fact, you can use it with just about anything that has Wi-Fi that has a modern Wi-Fi connection in it, like a cable set-top box, for instance, a wireless camera, game consoles, all sorts of things. A AirPort base station is really no different than a base station from another brand. It's just that it has more of the Apple flavor to it. It's got an Apple control panel that you can use in an iOS device and on your Mac, but it can still communicate with all of the other Wi-Fi devices in your house. And the last myth I want to talk about today has to do with Macs having only one mouse button. Now, originally Macs did have only one mouse button, and it's different from Windows that had a second mouse button. It was the right mouse button and you could right click. But even back in those days when Macs had one mouse button, you can hold down the control key and click on your mouse and you would get the same effect. You would get a contextual menu just like right clicking. But starting years and years ago, some Mac mice came with the second mouse button. It didn't look like it did. It's just that if you clicked on the left side versus the right side. And surely enough, the current Mac mouse that you get does that. But you can also do that with any other device, like say the trackpads on MacBooks or using the Magic Trackpad. Matter of fact, you have control over how this secondary click works. Go right in here into the system preferences, into trackpad in this case, or you can go into the mouse settings there. And on the trackpad, I've got a secondary click. I can say I'm going to do it when I click with two fingers, or I can do the bottom right corner or bottom left corner there. So I get to actually determine how that secondary click is activated on my trackpad. Most people stick with clicking with two fingers. So there are 9 Mac myths and misconceptions for you. Hope you found this useful. Till next time, this is Gary with MacMost Now. If you found this video useful, there's one thing you can do for me in return. It won't cost you anything and it will just take you a few seconds. If you're not already at MacMost.com, go there and then look for the video you just watched and go to that page. Underneath the video, you'll see a bunch of different links that help you share the video with friends. Take a second to click the like button. This sends a signal out to the rest of the internet that the video is worth watching. Thanks.